Monica George was a retired nurse living in Rockville, Maryland.
Yeah, I look back now that I'm a mother and see some of the ways that she was so good at encouraging us to be who we were becoming in ways that I can't imagine doing for my son when he's a teenager.
She had three daughters, Elaine, Andrea, and Donna.
You know, my mother was born in a family of seven siblings, so everyone kind of gathered round and made it, you know, the safe place where we were just showered with love and affection. And
she got sick in the end of July of 1998 and went into complete liver failure because of this drug. The Monica George case is probably one of the best examples of everything that went wrong with the drug Rezulin.
House of glasses, not my home anymore. The ties that bind will break us. So break up fast and don't look back. Just hit the rails and fall down fast. And we forget today and a little more tomorrow. And it comes to finding us. We find it then we follow. And when it falls away, falls just a little bit harder, and I've seen it all before. It's just another lonely day without me. The streets, this town, it's not my home anymore. Paid my dues in full. Ties that bind won't hold me down anymore. I've learned the golden rule. So hitch a ride to nowhere, not anywhere. Rails are bleeding fast as we fall down facing what we think might be forward. But I know that we're looking back. That we forget today and a little more tomorrow. When it comes to finding ours, find it then to follow. And when it falls on me, it falls just a little bit harder. And I've seen it all before. It's just another lonely day without me.
Rezulin was a pill for treating type 2 or adult onset diabetes.
The drug was supposed to help one's body metabolize the insulin that your body made.
It was the first of its class, so it was designed to treat diabetes in a new way.
Rezulin, in my view, was, since it's off the market now, essentially snake oil.
Warren Lambert liked to claim that Rezulin was a breakthrough drug, but it wasn't. It was just a knockoff drug. A lot of companies had drugs like this, but Warren Lambert just pushed Rezulin to market first.
They talk about Rezulin doing something unique, But the truth of the matter is that there was other medications out there. The
problem with the drug is why you're here. It shreds people's livers.
Well, a man called David Wellman, who was a reporter for the LA Times, broke a story of a drug called Rezulin that had political problems.
Well, I became interested in the drug in maybe late summer, fall of 1997. I was fascinated by it as a sort of a marketing sensation.
David Wellman won the Pulitzer Prize for a series of articles. He's the one that broke the Rezulin story.
Here's this drug that it was the fastest approved diabetes pill in the history of the FDA. Gets on the market and captures very significant market share and revenue real quickly.
He broke the story of some inappropriate conduct on behalf of the company in getting the drug approved, getting the drug to stay on the market. He wasn't focusing so much on safety, but more on the conduct of the company.
Without Mr. Wellman, it is probable that this story wouldn't have hit the skids, wouldn't have gone public.
Zoe was the first encouragement that we had gotten from a lawyer. You know, we had made the decision that we needed to do something. She was the first one who kind of added any energy to it.
Just, we're not, I don't like suing people.
Don and I had talked to two separate lawyers, and, you know, they were kind of, well, you know, to take on a drug company, that's a big deal.
One day I got a phone call from three women asking me about taking on their mother's case. She had died from liver failure, and her doctors felt it was caused by Rezulin.
Zoe's a lawyer from Houston, Texas. We met 2 years ago and formed Littlepage Booth to handle Rezulin cases.
She was born and raised in Barbados in the Caribbean.
She began to pretend and play lawyer games at a very early age.
I have two kids, Benny's 6 and Jordan's 2.
My mom is a lawyer. She fights with words. I love you, Mom, Ben.
My name is Rainey Booth. I'm 42 years old. I've been an attorney for 18 years.
Rainey and Betsy have been married since the dark ages.
I have 4 children. We live in Pensacola, Florida.
He's funny. He makes you laugh. You're always laughing.
A year and a half ago, One Lambert Park Davis gave us a room with a big long table and chairs down either side and said, here are 5 million documents, you figure out what we did wrong. So it's not that we go into a case knowing what we're looking for. We go into a case knowing nothing. And the concept is, you look at everything and you prove to us a case.
The first step of the discovery process was going to Pfizer's headquarters in New York City. So we sat in a room surrounded by boxes of documents and looked through documents page by page for, it had to be close to 14 weeks.
Then we started taking depositions of people, more than 100 days of depositions all over the country, every night a different hotel.
We were on the road so much, I didn't even unpack my suitcase. Just leave it open in the corner of my bedroom and put new stuff in it on Sunday afternoon.
Typically when he was doing depositions, he would leave on a Monday and come home on a Friday night. You know, every week he would be gone, almost like the traveling salesman.
I mean, some weeks we would be in a different city every day. Start a deposition in the morning, fly out that afternoon, start another deposition in another city the next day. Okay, listen to this. This is from Anthony Wilde. Start seeing the story get put together.
Dr. Wickham, my name is Zoe Littlepage. I met you briefly the last time your deposition was taken.
Will you tell us your full name, please?
My name is Barnaby Gould.
Good morning, Mr. Henshaw.
Good morning.
Okay, let me...
Would you state your full name, please?
Full name, oshiatte itadakemasu ka?
Watashi no namae wa Morita Akira desu.
My name is Akira Morita.
Dr. Martin, good morning.
Morning.
My name is Zoe Littlepage. You understand that I represent people injured by Rezulin around the country.
Do you swear the testimony you're about to give in this cause to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Yes.
I do.
I do.
Warner Lambert had a lot of doctors and scientists working on this drug. Did they know that this drug was a hepatotoxin? I think that's indisputable.
You have to keep in mind the company representatives, whenever they're asked a question, they don't know.
Did the study ever start?
I don't know.
Did the study ever end?
I don't know.
Well, I don't know what are you making reference to there?
I don't know.
I just don't know.
He was at that time a paid consultant to Warner Lambert Park Davis.
I don't know.
I've already said I don't know.
A lot of depositions, long days. There were times that we got frustrated.
There is no basis in any world I've ever lived in that you have a right to make that speech.
I don't think that's absolutely proper.
This witness
proper.
Is a very intelligent man. This witness will not let me mischaracterize. Do not let me mischaracterize your testimony.
Any idiot could say these numbers aren't the same. A monkey could say these numbers aren't the same. They're not the same.
You cannot stop me from speaking to this witness.
I am going to move for sanctions against
Fine.
You, Mr. Mayashik.
You go right ahead.
He did not answer the question
you
at lunch.
I'm going to ask my question.
Is irrelevant.
You made an objection. You made your objection.
Sit down and address questions to the witness.
Oh, no, I don't think so. Would you like to say the word objection, then we can move on?
Objection!
Thank you.
Is the number 39?
Don't answer the question. I direct the witness not to answer that question.
Okay, is that an objection, or are you coaching the witness?
When he supported the entire document, in its context, he says, don't use it long term. True?
No, that's not at all what he says.
Oh, so this sentence is out of context, or am I just misreading it?
You're misreading it.
I'm misreading it.
Okay. Well, I'm presuming it's because you don't understand the process.
Maybe I just can't read.
Zoe Littlepage, Rainey Booth, who've led the charge in the state court cases, have done a phenomenal job. These are the guys that really made this thing happen, there's no question about it. Kept the pressure on them.
The first issue we looked at was how and why did the FDA approve this drug?
We were pretty much just trying to figure out why it got approved and what they had told the FDA to approve it.
The way the FDA is set up is that every time a new drug comes in, there is one person who is assigned at the FDA as having the overall responsibility as to making the recommendation for approval or non-approval of the drug.
Dr. John Grigan, known to everyone as Dr. G, was assigned by the FDA to review the drug Rezulin.
He worked on Rezulin for more than 7 years.
A key witness is John Grigan, who back then was the FDA medical officer in charge of Rezulin and warned of liver damage before it hit the market.
And Dr. Grigan had some true concerns about the drug. He did not believe the drug worked as well as the company said it did or represented that it did. And he did not believe the drug was as safe as the company said it was.
My job was to look at it as objectively as possible, bringing all my knowledge, all my experience, all my gut feeling about a drug, and recommending approval or non-approval. And then I said, from what you showed me, guys, I don't think this drug should be approved, as simple as that.
The George case was the third Rezulin case tried. There was already a history to this litigation.
We are pleased to announce, on behalf of our client, Margie Sanchez, that today she was awarded by an Oasis County jury the amount of $43 million in actual damages.
She had liver failure. She's on a liver transplant list.
My name is Chris Pinedo, attorney for Margie Sanchez. I practice here in Corpus Christi. We asked the jury today to send a message. And they have sent a message. They've sent a message to corporate America, which will reach their boardrooms in New Jersey, that this company knew their drug was defective. They knew it would harm people. They knew it would kill people. They lied to doctors. They lied to the FDA. They lied to the public.
I understand from people who polled those jurors, that jury was considering punitive damages in excess of $100 million.
I'm very thankful for what the jury did today, taking my side.
Rainey and I tried the second Rezulin case in Liberty, Missouri.
We went to Missouri to try the Griggs case right before Thanksgiving.
I was the first jury member that they selected. And the jurors deliberated for about 4 days after the month-long trial. But the conduct of Warner Lambert was interesting. As I reflect back on it, it's almost as if they broke the golden rule. They lied, they deceived, they were less than forthright with information. We found in the, for the plaintiff,
the jury was about to bring back a $26 million verdict, and the family decided to accept the settlement that Warner Lambert offered them.
I was thinking along the lines of $80 to $100 million for punitive damages, because what Warner Lambert did, in my opinion, was just wrong. And I wanted them to know that don't come back here doing this, because we're not going to take it.
We moved straight from Missouri to here.
We moved into the Maryland apartments the day after Christmas.
I think everyone's exhausted physically from the late nights and all the hard work, but excited coming from the win of the one trial in Missouri, but nervous because it's a whole new ballgame. We rent, you know, the furniture that we need, beds, a couple of tables, but that's basically it.
Poorly furnished usually don't have a phone for a couple of weeks in. We move our Xerox machines in, we move all our files in, but we share rooms.
We cram people in. I mean, there's four of us to a room in one of the rooms.
It's almost like being in a college dorm. It just gets to be kind of funny. I mean, there's nothing that I don't know about Leah. There's nothing I don't know about Leah's boyfriends.
Oh, how dare you stand up in front of this jury and say it's not in any way related to our drug?
You know, we have a lot of laughs, but it can also be really stressful at times.
Just looking back, that was such an ideal existence. I mean, we lived in this really tiny town. I think Elizabethtown had about 7,000 people. And, this is in the early 60s. And we just had such complete freedom. We could just roam around the town, even though we were little kids, never had to worry about strangers or... I mean, when I think about that, it was fantastic.
She lost her husband when she was 23 or 24, had two small children. She lost a second husband, our stepfather from a brain tumor. My mother was just had such an ability to pick up her life and be stronger from the adversity that she had in her life.
I thought you were going to tell the story about her teaching us the song, "You Can Roll a Silver Dollar Down the Barroom Floor."
The sisters thought that was just hysterical. Yeah. Yeah. But that's the kind of person my mother was. She liked to...
She had a mischievous sense.
Yeah, she did.
She was happy, healthy, recently retired, just fallen in love, living a... true golden year scenario. She was traveling. She had joined all kinds of societies and groups in order to do all the hobbies she'd never had time to do before. Really in the best part of her life.
My mother had faith in medicine. She really did. Mm-hmm.
She got sick in the end of July of 1998.
And then she went into this place where she is severely swollen, so jaundiced, I mean her eyeballs were almost green, and suffering, truly suffering. She was taken to Johns Hopkins, the family, everybody was there, and she couldn't move herself. She was not just swollen in the stomach, but her legs, so they started tapping her and drawing out, almost a gallon of liquid from her stomach, which made her feel immensely better. They were just questioning everything that, and then she started from their treatment getting better. So this was, we had the sense that, mother was going to make it through this.
As her liver started shutting down, every given day, the doctors felt that there was a chance that they could reverse the process and they could stop the liver dying and the liver might regenerate. So she was not permitted pain medication as she went into liver failure on the hope that the liver would regenerate and to try and stop any further damage to the liver.
And her heels start breaking down. She has these big black necrotic areas on her heels. So she's a nurse. She's watching her body rot. And, and then going in and out of the confusion. So she's so agitated that she's trying to pull out the tubes and claw herself because of this rash, and they put her in restraints so that, and on top of that, they give her medication, the only hope to clear the toxins is to create this constant diarrhea, so that it's, you know, an attempt to clear her body of the toxins. So she's constantly, you know, laying in her own diarrhea and you know, with restraint. So, you know, we change her, and, you know, she soiled herself within 5 minutes. So, you know, this was, and she's crying out, mercy, mercy, mercy.
She died in absolute agony without any assistance of pain medication, in restraints because the pain was so great. She was clawing at herself and scratching at herself to try and relieve the pain. She was in hepatic confusion, in and out of hepatic confusion, which means her family couldn't really help her or calm her. She didn't recognize them at different periods of time. And in the last couple of days of her life, she was vomiting up blood, restrained, moaning, crying, pleading for help, and died in true pain, true, true pain.
This was like just such a cruel death because she didn't have anything.
She so wanted to stay alive a little bit longer. She asked, her wish was to see her grandchildren graduate from kindergarten. And then the last day, she started to clear. You know, she had been in and out of this confusion. And, you know, I was doing the exercises and brushing her hair and, you know, things that she liked us to do, and sang her a song. And you know, by the time the doctors got there, mother was vomiting up bright red blood. And, you know, the doctors are asking me, do you want us to try to do anything? And at that point, Sister Ignatia had come. She had been with me for a half an hour longer with a friend of hers, Sister Winifred. And Sister Winnie said, Elaine, let her go, let her go. But it was clear that now her color changed, her eyes rolled back, she's vomiting blood. It's like, this is it.
This is how she's gonna die. We start in the morning with jury selection. Ultimately, we're gonna have 6 jurors. It has to be a unanimous verdict. We cannot lose a single juror.
Before we started trial, Zoe and Rainey had a staff meeting, and they spoke to us and told us, you know, that, look, we're coming from a win, but we have to give the sworn everything we have, and that they're going to come at us with everything they have, and they're going to come at us better, bigger, and faster, and we have to be on top of everything and ready to roll.
The sense of the group was it was going to be an easier trial. We had doctors on our side, we had science on our side, the company had admitted the drug killed her in their own documents. It was one of the cases they'd reported to the FDA. So it was with great relief and optimism we walked into the Maryland trial.
Cameras were everywhere. It was a big media case.
I've been having a hard time trying to justify the clouds arising from the cars we drive. Been a little too easy, see, it's just a little too hard today. And I'm afraid my children are gonna have to watch the world waste away.
CBS News investigation of Rezulin. The diabetes drug was linked to dozens of deaths and was taken off the market. But that was not the end of the story or the controversy. A new chapter is opened now in a court in Maryland. CBS's Cheryl Atkinson has this follow-up.
Monica George's family blames her death on Rezulin. George was prescribed the diabetes drug in 1997, then went into a tailspin that ended in liver failure.
We're going into Maryland, which is truly, in my opinion, from a factual standpoint, the best case of Rezulin injury that I've seen in the country. It's also the most compelling case. It was the case that the 60 Minutes program about Rezulin involved. It was compelling because of the way this poor lady died. It was compelling because of the nature of her diabetes was not severe or even serious from the standpoint of the treatment she needed. It's compelling because her daughters were remarkable people, true courage, not in this for money, but in this to make a difference and make a change.
The world's largest pharmaceutical company is in court here in Rockville. I'm Tony Dorsey. I'll tell you why.
Was Rezulin a good drug at all, or what did Pfizer do wrong?
I believe that the evidence in the case is going to be that it is not a good drug.
What could they have done better? What did they not do?
We believe that there is strong evidence presented in other trials that this drug was poorly developed, showed clear signs of liver injury very early on, and showed the type and the severity of risk that's unacceptable.
Thank you very much.
Hey, everybody stay right there.
Real quick.
I'm going to get a wide shot. Rob, ask him just another question. Good. For you?
Good. Rainey Booth, is that right?
Yes.
R-E-I-N-E-Y.
R-A-I-N-E-Y.
R-A-I-N-E-Y. B-O-O-T-H.
Right. Obviously, you don't believe they adequately argued their position.
The reality is all drugs have risks. But the risks that drugs have are of headaches and dry mouth and nausea. What is inappropriate is to put a drug on the market that has a risk of death or liver failure at the rate that this drug did.
The jury will watch you. They will watch you to see your reaction. And so be very, very aware, okay, everywhere you go that a juror could be watching
don't
you.
Don't take anybody's parking space and
don't cut anybody off.
You know, I mean, obvious things, but... You know, when somebody cuts you off, just wave and say thank you very much. Don't give any sign of anger or irritation because they'll be the foreman.
Yeah. Okay.
Your first witness is going to be a doctor, and I anticipate he'll testify for a couple of days. Give us who he is and what you hope that he'll bring to this trial.
Our first witness will be Dr. John Garigian, who is a former FDA medical officer who actually was assigned this drug. So he has both factual knowledge and he will be testifying as an expert on his review of documents and scientific journals. Hi, Dr. G.
Hey.
Thank you.
Come on in.
Garigian's
going to
be soon.
Hi.
I see you again.
How are you? Good to
please,
see you.
Please, don't.
Happy New Year to you.
So
how do you pronounce that doctor's name again?
Garigian.
Garigian, thank you.
So you call your first witnesses today?
Yes, Dr. Garigian will take the stand this afternoon right after lunch.
He's a bit controversial simply because this outburst, and even your side has admitted that.
Yes.
From 1991 to 1996, I had raised my concerns and communicated my concerns as a medical officer should to the company. And they had said, yes, we're going to do that, we're going to address that issue, and never did. So this was the upting time that somebody from the company was coming and telling me, with a big smile on their face, how can we help you?
Now it comes time for the drug to be approved. And he, as a representative of the taxpayers of this country, has to make a decision whether to approve the drug or not. He feels under tremendous pressure. It's just as bad to keep good drugs off the market as to put bad drugs on the market. So he is tasked by the federal government to make that decision. He has a meeting with a company representative from Warner Lambert Park Davis, a woman called Mary Taylor. And in that meeting, he gets very angry.
How can we help you? I say, well, I thought you were told how you can help me. You've been told this for 6 years.
Can we help you? Do you have everything? The drug's coming up for approval. Are we all set to get the drug approved? And he loses it.
So I lost it because it was very close to that time where I had to give the yay or nay answer. And I was put in a very impossible position.
He loses his temper. He uses profanity. He acts very inappropriately.
Her accusations were that I used intemperate language, which I did, and that I was biased against the drug, which I wasn't.
Talking about the September 25th meeting with Dr. Gurgian, did he seem angry?
I would say yes. This is a man that's, you know, basically yelling across the, you know, a very small little tiny office at me, saying, you know, at the top of his lungs with a lot of, you know, swearing in between.
And what Warner Lambert Park Davis does is they use that as an excuse to get a medical officer removed from their drug that they knew had serious concerns about the safety of their drug. So they go to the FDA, they file an official complaint saying that he acted inappropriately, and they request his removal. The FDA does an investigation. He admits that he lost his temper. He tells the FDA why.
How can anyone explain that a company is coming and saying, how can we help you, if they never did help, despite all their promises?
Warner Lambert Park Davis is successful at getting him removed from the drug.
What I saw of him during his testimony, I think that Dr. Gurgian can be hot-headed, probably a real quick temper, but at the same time, he's the exact right person at the FDA that I want looking after me.
Gurgian will tell jurors that Warner Lambert and senior FDA officials ignored his warnings in a rush to get Rezulin to market. He was taken off the case, and the FDA approved Rezulin without the strongest label warning, a black box, to alert patients and doctors.
What we found out from the company's documents was that they realized how important it was to have him removed from this drug, and they expressed great relief at his removal.
I remember clearly the day we found that internal Park Davis memo discussing the fact that Dr. John Gurgian had been removed from reviewing the drug Rezulin. It stated that, you know, they were celebrating the fact that John had been removed, that they were over the JG hurdle, and, you know, that they were past the unknown time bomb. And we sat there in amazement, couldn't believe the words we were reading.
So give me that wide shot and then tight shot of the pics.
Are you guys going to meet somewhere else?
He's going to probably come down.
Soon or later?
Later.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would definitely say that in the Monica George case, Charlie Goodell is a worthy opponent. We're here in Charlie Goodell's backyard. This is his home state. So every nuance of this state's laws, he knows.
Goodell is like almost somebody's grandfather. If I was Pfizer, that's who I would want representing me.
I like Mr. Goodell.
I do too. He stays out of the deal, though. He doesn't engage. When he doesn't do it in a fair way, which I, you know...
You don't think so?
No, he really doesn't. He came in and he said some things to the judge, which, you know...
Today?
It's kind of like, well, I'm not saying Rainey stole anything, but he stuck his hand in my pants and took my wallet and then took the money out and put the money in his wallet and then put the wallet, threw them out in the trash can and didn't give it back to me and then attempted to pretend like it was his money. I'm not saying he stole anything. Okay, so which part of it was me not stealing something, you know? If you want to say I stole something, you know, grab your sack and say you stole something, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe that's unfair.
Issue was the NIH death and whether the judge was going to let it in. Audrey Jones was a volunteer in an NIH study. She was a teacher in Missouri. She didn't have diabetes. And because it was the NIH, National Institute of Health, I mean, you would assume it was a well-run, well-designed study.
And I keep on thinking, for some reason, of Audrey Jones in that NIH study, because she didn't even have diabetes. And someone told me she was doing it because her son had diabetes.
What actually happens is Rezulin kills her liver, and then she gets a liver transplant. And in the course of liver transplant, she develops some other complications, which along with the liver failure lead to her death. Death becomes very important because it's a tremendous black eye for the drug and for the NIH. So the NIH has to step up and say, someone died in our study who wasn't even a diabetic.
Here's a woman who is monitored under the most precise conditions we can impose in an NIH clinical trial. And the woman still plunged into fulminant hepatic failure and death. This seemingly, at that point in time, was evidence that monitoring could not be relied upon. Yet the FDA chose either not to learn anything from that incident or to take action that was tepid, to say the least.
I mean, when I saw how Mother died and realized that all these other people died the same way, and I don't know, for some reason, Audrey Jones really just you know, all these deaths happened and nothing was really done about it. I mean, they just kept on going full steam ahead with the drug.
Okay, lessons learned for us. Mr. Goodell has decided, rightfully, that the only way to beat us is to beat you.
Yes.
And
I mean, prevent me from talking.
Correct. Prevent you from talking. And through the disruption, he disrupts our flow.
Rhythm.
And the rhythm. And as a result, we weren't good today. Okay? We as a team were not good today. I want you to sit up. I want you to focus on Zoe. I want you to be in on it. If Zoe asks you a question for yes or no, say yes or no. If she wants you to explain, Zoe will ask you to explain. If you do that and you establish that with her, she will ask you less leading questions so you can establish a rapport with a jury. And then it won't look like she's leading you around and telling you what to say.
Well, she's got a tough job.
Judge McGuckian allowed the defense to destroy the flow of our presentation about it.
There is pretty much no risk.
Tomorrow we're going to address the Janet McGill issue. She was one of the clinical investigators for Warner Lambert. She actually ran one of the human studies.
Janet McGill was involved in the earlier clinical trials in the early 90s involving human volunteers taking Rezulin.
She later came out publicly and said that Warner Lambert had lied about her results.
Janet McGill wrote Congress, Senator Kennedy, and asked Congress to conduct hearings to take the drug Rezulin off the market.
You reported to Senator Kennedy that 85 patients who had taken the drug had died or required liver transplants by March the 1st, 2000. And you requested that Senator Kennedy call a congressional inquiry into the safety of the drug troglitazone. Isn't that true?
I'm sorry, but I declined to answer that question. I wish to invoke my Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination.
And then after you wrote those two letters, is when you found out you were the subject of a criminal investigation.
I'm sorry, on the advice of counsel, I declined to answer that question. I wish to invoke Fifth Amendment rights against self-incrimination.
On March 1st, 2000, you told Senator Edward Kennedy that Warner Lambert Park Davis was a company that clearly placed profits before the lives of patients. Isn't that true?
I am sorry. On advice of counsel, I decline to answer that question.
She has refused to talk about the issues surrounding her study in light of some investigations that have been started against her when she spoke out the first time. I mean, the one thing you learn very quickly is if you speak out against Warner Lambert Park Davis, you speak out against a very powerful, very large company. And there is a tremendous force brought to bear to shut you up.
Yeah, Warner Lambert wants you to be quiet, don't they? They don't want you to speak up in this deposition.
Objection form.
Was that you, Mr. Carlson?
Yeah, I'm not sure that was a question. I object to it as a sidebar, but it wasn't a question.
If it's a question, I decline to answer it. I'm invoking Fifth Amendment rights.
I don't think you will ever, as journalist, see a case where a person who's in charge of trying to determine whether or not the drug that the company is going to sell is safe has to plead the Fifth Amendment. In this case, we actually had the scientist who was commenting and supposed to be determining whether or not the product was safe had to plead the Fifth Amendment.
Okay, so what do you think about today? What do we do about the McGill issue?
I think it hurts that the judge wouldn't let us play her deposition. I know Dr. G got to talk about it, but you know, it's not the same thing.
You have to give this jury the impression that you are hard working to get them the information as quickly and as clearly as possible. And some of the things that you can do which
you
don't give that impression.
You sugarcoated, you were too long.
No, I'm not. You hush your mouth.
Your answers were too long.
No, because some of that stuff was very important. You stay out of this, I'm handling this.
Let me tell you something. You were trying to control too much early on, and it made it sound like you were leading. This is a smart jury. So what he was doing is he was establishing rapport that was important. But then it got to be too much.
Tomorrow is our day. Okay? We take tomorrow.
Yes, Coach.
I'm serious, man.
I'm serious too, Coach.
This is you.
Oh, thank you.
Would you please leave because I finished
here? We still work on the weekends. It's just not as hectic and a little bit more low-key. Once in a while, a couple of us will go and find the local hot spot and have a couple of drinks.
So where were you Friday night, Josh?
Working? Where do you think I was?
Where were you Saturday night, Josh?
Where were you, Moody?
Working.
Shouting your booty for every man in the whole club.
My oldest two kids came up for the first week of trial. Elizabeth's 15, Rainey's 13. They've been helping out, making copies, going to court with us.
And before it was just, I didn't really understand that it was such a big deal what he was doing. But after seeing the reaction of the public and the cameras, it was really, it made it all make sense. And I understood why he was gone.
He's forgotten that, you know, who Dad is, and basketball, and the game, and he needs a lesson. So he's gone and bought a basketball, and we got a court down the street.
Okay, did we just lose George, you think?
No, I'm not even in there. They're right there.
Go!
Yeah, that was, good.
Can you edit that part
I guess
part
you thought
off?
You were a lot closer, huh?
Can you edit that part off?
Got up this morning, and dropped my kids to the airport so they can fly home. It's hard to drop them.
Monica George died under the care of Dr. Stephen Caldwell at the University of Virginia. Dr. Caldwell ordered an autopsy and ended up publishing a paper with a pathology resident, Dr. Allison Booth, about Monica George's death.
The jury's going to like you. Okay, the jury's going to like you, and they're going to like what you did because you're the only one that did the right thing. You're the one that reported this case to the MedWatch system, and you know, you're the one that cared enough to write the report. You held the liver in your hand, you looked at every part of it, you drew conclusions based on your experience, and then you shared those conclusions with the other members of UVA who are not, you know, being criticized for being too young. In fact, some of whom they've hired now as their experts. They're going to try to get you on the possibles, all the other things that could have been, and they're going to try to attack you again on your age.
Good. I thought you did real good. Terrible. She did good.
Terrible? She did good on direct, she did terrible on cross. Rennie fixed it a little bit on redirect, but overall,
she did very well.
Weak.
I didn't think Amber was very good.
You didn't?
What?
She was good.
She was awesome, Zoe. Grace was a good witness just because she seemed really sincere, like she never testified before, and you could tell.
They were being intellectually dishonest, and she was letting them. And I think over lunch she said, why am I doing that? You know, why am I giving up on stuff I don't have to give up on?
I think she got pissed off they were putting down her article too.
And she came back with, not with an attitude, but with a, okay, I'm not just going to give in on every question. And what she learned is as soon as she stopped giving in, they stopped asking her questions. And so it empowered her to keep not giving in. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I thought she did pretty well.
Yeah, so did I.
Dr. Julie was called in to see Monica George the first day she went into the hospital. By sheer luck, he had just published an article about Rezulin causing liver injuries, and he recognized immediately what was causing her problems.
This company killed their mother, and finally somebody with a brain stands up and explains how it happened, and the way you did it was perfect. Don't you cave on them tomorrow.
Okay, I'll be tough. I just want to know where he's coming from. You got to just
all right,
tell me
where he's
coming
from. Let me tell you the issues, okay?
You know.
Let me tell you the issues. Now look, the thing they're coming after you about is that you made new opinions.
Okay.
All right, here's what they want to tell the jury. You made new opinions that you didn't have. You've created science that doesn't exist anywhere else in this world. And you're a paid whore who's too stupid to do anything but small-town clinical medicine.
Uh-huh.
All right? They want to piss you off and change your demeanor.
Uh-huh.
It's your testimony, not his. You have to be right.
Okay?
Dr. Julie was really great on the stand. He's believable, he's likable, and he's a great guy, and I think that came off.
What I think happened in terms of what went on is that she experienced the most severe form of Rezulin-induced liver toxicity.
Anything interesting happened?
We kicked butt.
Is the case
case almost over?
Nope. Not for another week. No.
Okay, what's the law?
But it seems like he's saying, though, that...
Do I come to the middle of your conversation?
Yeah, you do, actually. Let me see.
But it seems like he's saying, you know, yeah, that's relevant evidence, but you can't bring it in through...
Dr. Gurgian.
What do you mean?
It's not a negligence test.
That's why there's comment K.
Okay, that's not the law.
It's whether the manufacturer...
If today they issued a press release that said this drug is directly toxic, this jury gets to look at it. And he said, that is not my understanding of the law. Mr. Goodell, do you agree with her interpretation? Of course, Goodell goes, No, I don't.
This case has been a lot different and a lot harder to put on from our last case because of the way the evidence is coming in. It's not coming in, and that's the problem. It's the judge isn't allowing the jury to see the evidence, and that when he does allow the evidence to come in, it's coming in so choppy. There's no rhyme or reason to what he's doing.
Today's Benny's birthday. I called him this morning to sing him happy birthday on the phone, but he left for school already.
She talks to them a lot. She explains the reasons why she's not around and what the trials are all about.
The sad thing to me is you adapt. You become used to him being away because he's missing a lot of stuff, a lot of dances and just a lot of important things to me.
And you know you're going to be gone for weeks at a time, months.
No, because I used to tell my dad everything, and since he hasn't been here, I've had to rely more on my mom. Because of his being away, I'm much more independent. Once you do this, it does get in your blood. I do think he's changed. I mean, our children, they're growing up, and he's not here. It makes me sad. I would never hold him back, but I think the cost has been exceedingly high.
When you saw her that last morning,
yes,
was your impression that she was really on death's door?
I didn't want to think so. I think really I knew it, but I didn't want to let myself believe it because she was just so sick. But I guess I wanted her so badly to get better that I didn't want to let myself know how bad she was. But yes, I believe I knew it.
We wanted the jury to hear from Sister Ignatia because she was actually there on the last day, the day of Monica George's death.
Okay, 10 months, anybody can figure out what this is.
What is it?
A mystery stew.
Oh, we got mystery stew today?
It's got some peas.
Ooh.
And it's got some...
Okay, somebody give it to me.
I don't know. I give $10 to anybody that can figure out what the hell is.
It's Friday night and my kids are coming in.
Obviously loves her kids, you know, tremendously. She misses them, you know, a great deal. And fortunately, at least she has the ability to bring them to her to some of these trials. So she does get to spend, you know, time with them on weekends. And
she has a lot of trials, and that's why I don't see her very much. She always goes out of town, but sometimes I go with her. Mommy, go work. She always tells me she loves me and that she's gonna see me soon.
Well, I think that her career is so much a part of her and it drives her so much that if she had to give the career up and just be a mom, I don't think she would be as happy a person as she is. If she had to do one or the other, and if it was only being a mom without the career to give her the drive and whatever's in her life, I don't think that she would be so happy with that. I think she would think that was dull to be just a mom.
It's going to be tough. It'll be the most difficult year, I think, that she's had to face so far.
I love you, Mommy.
Good
company had a MedWatch system, which was a system that the company used to track people hurt by their drug. In that system, they gave each person a number. Monica George's number was 990274.
Okay, so 0991 as the start of a patient's name means that they were exposed to Rezulin.
Troglitazone.
And then there is a six-digit number, which is a number assigned to each individual patient.
Correct.
Now, the first one that's probably related, the individual patient number is 990274.
Mm-hmm.
Correct?
Yes, it looks that way.
Do you know who that is?
Do I? No.
Would the database have contained the name of the person that represented 990274?
Probably not at all.
Do you know that's the person that I represent whose case we're here on?
No, I did not know that.
Has anybody ever told you that 990274 is Monica George, whose family I represent?
No.
But when it comes to things about their own department, like the MedWatch number on a patient in the, you know, the database that Rose Rogan would be in charge of, she has really no idea about any of it.
I have a question off the record. How can you find that out from the number?
Because I have a MedWatch form.
Oh, it's on. You can link it with the MedWatch form.
Okay.
Patient names are not supposed to be in the database at all.
I know what day she died. I know how old she was when she died. I know her birth date.
And their explanation is that because the MedWatch numbers are intended to give confidentiality, you don't know the patient's name. Well, okay, but you're in a lawsuit, and the biggest case in the country that you're facing is Monica George's case. You know you have MedWatches on this woman. You know this woman's death is reported. It's ridiculous to think that they didn't go back and put the two together when we did it in 15 minutes. So I think that's you know, a lie.
I think I know which one you're talking about.
990274.
Yep.
And was this a death case?
They selected like 35 cases they reported to the FDA where their expert, Paul Watkins, had said, okay, this is a Rezulin injury.
All right. And can you tell me what your assessment was on this case?
Probably related. That's what it says.
Okay.
I don't clearly remember this patient specifically, but it sounds familiar. Vaguely familiar,
her
particularly
name is,
the autoantibodies here.
Her name is Monica George. Does that ring any bells to you?
Only because I first heard that name last night.
This company, as the evidence is going to be, took the position early on that Rezulin was the cause of this woman's death. And now they are contesting that, which is obviously very difficult for the family to hear. And I think that's one of the reasons the family feels so strongly is that this company needs to take responsibility. They took responsibility early on. They reported her death to the FDA as caused by this drug. And now they come into a courtroom and they tell the jury that the drug had no role in her death. And that is the purpose of this case, is for this company to not be allowed to do that anymore.
It never even occurred to us that this judge would keep out the evidence of this company's assessment of Monica George.
This is Twilight Zone world, yeah. You know, the I mean, way this judge
not,
is ruling.
It was never, I mean, we thought it was not even an issue.
I would have done it differently if I thought it was going to be an issue.
We would have introduced the whole issue first.
I would have shown, I would have told the jury what the documents were first,
right.
And then when they didn't let him in, the jury would know. But I just, in my mind...
Yeah. It was never,
you know,
an issue that a document that dealt specifically with your mom and your mom's case would not come in.
We always thought that showing the jury the evidence about the company's motive, why they did what they did, why they did it when they did, and using their own documents was important.
You have to examine their motives, and the motives are very clear. It's a person that's driven by one consideration, greed.
Warner Lambert Park Davis was in serious financial trouble.
Was it your perception as an officer of the company in 1996 that the company was facing financial challenges?
The company was believed to be facing some challenges.
What circumstance?
Well, a patent expiration on the big drug. The R&D group had not been consistently productive. There wasn't perceived to be a healthy pipeline coming. The one of the drugs that they had hoped to kind of turn the company around wasn't looking so good. So a whole variety of things at that particular time.
In the 1996 time frame, they were considered by Wall Street as a takeover candidate. They had low sales, and they had had some commercial disasters, and they had had some criminal convictions where they had been caught falsifying data to the FDA and had had to pay a huge fine.
The criminal convictions occurred about the same time that Rezulin was being developed. Park Davis had lied to the FDA about some test failures, some test results on another drug.
Okay, looking again at the conviction itself. It was a felony? True?
Yes.
Park Davis pled guilty.
Well, can we agree that there were some testing failures that were not reported and were concealed by Warden Lambert Park Davis, which formed the basis of the criminal conviction?
That is accurate.
The judge found their conduct to be egregious and outrageous. The judge ordered Park Davis to pay the maximum fine, which was $10 million.
You said the consequences were in the range of $1 billion. Is that a fair statement?
Correct, yes. It's a figure that we often used.
So you have a history of a firm, of a company, that is in financial trouble. And coming to market is a blockbuster drug, or a potentially blockbuster drug, that can save the company. And we have a number of documents that talk about this drug being the savior of this company. This is the drug that's going to transform the fortunes of Warren Lambert Park Davis.
We discussed that Rezulin was referred by you as a potential blockbuster product for the company, correct?
Yes.
As one of the flagship products of the company, correct?
Yes.
Rezulin is what Park Davis's future depends on, correct?
Yes.
This is the drug that they need to work, has to work, for this company to survive.
One of the best examples of Rezulin's importance to Warren Lambert was when we found the document that Robert Zerbe wrote.
Of a presentation I made to the, it was a group, a senior management group, internal meeting for Warren Lambert.
Was a presentation to senior management where basically he's telling the upper level senior executives that if they pull this off, we'll all eat like kings.
Once Rezulin hits the market, the company's stock price soars.
We find that the company is tracking their sales. We even find in Rose Rogan's own handwriting where they're looking at the impact on their sales of the deaths from this drug, where she is looking at monthly sales divided by deaths.
You want any better evidence of greed? The public should go take a look at when these insiders who are running this company decided to sell a lot of their stock. You know, coincidentally, you see insiders, guys who ran this company, including their CEO, selling stock a week or two before the drug was withdrawn from the market.
And in that year, I exercised a very large quantity of options I'd acquired over many years, and that was to the order of $31.4 million.
That also indicates that there's some information flowing from someone at the FDA to someone at Warren Lambert.
But I don't think that that's a hard fact for a juror to digest.
Then you have, you know, people higher up in the corporation that made very intentional decisions to minimize and downplay the risk of this drug because they saw that it had a huge potential for profit.
Why would you keep a drug on the market that's hurting people? Because you're making $1 billion on it. That's a lot of money. It's a lot of cabbage.
I think that the litigation may have the effect of giving the public a greater understanding of exactly who, what was going on, who knew what and when, why were decisions made, why were they not made.
Judge gutted the motive case today, didn't let in our documents. The jury doesn't understand the motive. I mean, they're never going to accept this company did what they did.
You know, and it just kind of makes you, you know, kind of makes you sick.
What troubles me too is, yeah, having to cry in public. I mean, it just, you know, at some point you go, God, is this a performance? You know, because I really don't want to bare my soul like this.
This was hell for me to get up there, and yet I've been so clear all along. This is what needs to happen. This, I need to tell Mother's story, but I really hate public speaking, or, you know, I hate that, although I'm a teacher. I mean, it's a really different kind of atmosphere. And but, you know, in doing it, I knew that I had to keep it together to tell Mother's story, that if I started crying, I'd probably not be able to stop. So, you know, I got through to the end without crying, but then there was just this, I couldn't stop crying. I'm still in the stand, and what I wanted to do is just disappear. I mean, literally, I kind of went into a ball, like maybe they'll not notice me anymore. And since then, it's been like scratching, you know, a scab off a wound. I can't stop thinking about Mother's suffering.
My feelings about my mother, you know, dying such a horrible death are my feelings, and that's really not, you know, for public consumption. Let's talk about, you know, the facts of it. And to have to go in the witness stand and do that was really, that was tough. That was tough.
The defense is trying to say that she had 5 years to live. I mean, but we have videotape of her dancing and singing, and she's healthy and she's playing with her grandbabies. I mean, she's like my mom, you know.
And the story you told about she would map out the, you know, the place right. to go by the
trash. I mean, that's her personality.
She took everything right. very serious. She had a calendar. She right. figured she it out. Organized. And she was exactly the same way with her health. She took it very seriously. She right. understood
very
the
organized.
Significance of it. She took her medical conditions very seriously, and she, you know, she paid attention.
I mean, the jury has to know your mom. They have to know her before, they have to know her as a mom, they have to know her as an adult, they have to know her as the person that died in suffering. And the three of you are the only ones that can do it, because she's not here to do it for herself.
So, okay.
But see, they'll ask questions, and I'll think afterwards, oh, I should have told that story.
Don't
you know,
do that to yourself. Because that's what wakes me up for the last 2 months.
Oh, really?
Just forget it.
You do the best you can.
I mean, the timing is bad. I mean, you know, we're truly getting stuff done, but we're running out of time.
I can tell.
It's very hard now.
And the defendants know it. And so they are taking all advantage of it, knowing that we are truly on a deadline. And anything we don't do is good for them, because everything we do is bad for them.
Feels like we've been here for months already. The apartments are starting to feel like home.
It's part of the bonding of the trial team that we live together. It means by a couple of weeks into the trial, everybody's tearing their hair out.
Our trial team does really do the work of, you know, 20 as they get ready for each day.
Tell me what Defense Exhibit 1004 is.
Defense Exhibit 1004 is State Exhibit 5006.
Could you guys refax the one for Rogan? Because I never got that one. Yeah, I'm gonna take it over to Zoe in a second. I just got it. Okay, well, if you'll fax it over, I'll take it over. Thank you. Bye.
Weasel.
Is your phone on end, Josh?
What?
Is your phone on end?
You know, I'm awed by what she does in the courtroom sometimes. I it's difficult for me to believe that that person standing there is our little Zoe. I'm very proud of what she's doing. And I see her in a completely different light in the courtroom. I see her, you know, up against these high-powered lawyers from these big firms and whatever, and the way she conducts herself and the way she can handle herself in the face of all that adversity.
I'm working here, okay? I'm not chatting on personal phone call.
I was given depo summaries.
Yes, you were given.
I'm much too important to do that.
Okay, tell me what you thought of it, because I need to deal with it in close if you thought it was anyway good. I thought
my only concern, he was way too good of a speaker.
Do I think we lost today?
No.
No.
Did he make me nervous today?
Where are you going?
Yes.
Yeah, but did he seem so staged?
He listed his credentials. They were this long. And poor Dr. Booth is...
Okay,
know,
but you've got Caldwell
and
Izoni and Sturgill.
See, this is what Rainey said, and I think this is true. Today is a decisive day, because it wasn't like he said, it could be this or it could be that, I just think it's this. He said, it is not what you see, it's what I see. So if the jury buys what he says, we lose. The jury buys what we say,
that's
we
all
lose.
I'm trying to tell y'all.
There's always something that has to be done for the next day. And then there's different shifts. Some people stay up all night, some people sleep a few hours and then get up.
There's always somebody awake in the war room.
since I have to do everything.
Some of the people on the trial team, I mean, they're just absolutely hilarious all the time. I mean, like, Josh, it only gets worse when you get sleepy.
You're fired! You're all fired!
You're
doing this
work.
Yes,
he's still there.
Did Rainey and Zoe need anything?
I did not ask because I was scared that they would tell me.
I want the med watch. I want the company. I want the FDA. I've got it written down, but in addition...
Generally speaking, there's activity in the apartments all through the night, every night, as we get ready for the next day.
The Watkins assessment sheet where he says how he does it.
Warner Lambert has offered money to settle this case to the family, and Zoe and Rainey have, you know, taken the offer to the family, but they won't even discuss it. They won't even allow Zoe and Rainey to counteroffer.
When I first met the daughters, they made us promise that we would never try to settle the case, that we would never try to take money for the case, that we would promise that if they hired us to do the case, we would take the case all the way through because it was that important to them.
I mean, these people literally, I mean, they would not accept $20 million today. They're just so convinced that Rezulin killed their mother, and they're so mad.
They are outraged that this company was able to behave this way. And that is their true motivation.
It didn't matter whether or not they collected 10 cents. What mattered was that in a public courtroom, out in the middle of all of the cameras and in front of anyone who wanted to see, Pfizer would have to answer for what they did. That's all that mattered to this family.
My hope is this sends a message. I have no delusions that we're going to hurt the drug company financially. But I think what we can do is create an atmosphere of awareness, you know, bring the public's attention to this so that drug companies will know they can't just do this stuff and pay people off, you know, have settlements where they slap on confidentiality orders so you can't talk about it, that they will know that there are people who are willing to go through the hell of a trial so that their voices can be heard.
So it makes them feel better about the decisions that they have made, okay?
You have any comment about this?
Not today, thanks.
I think that was,
First.
Okay?
Hmm?
First, right after that.
First? Yes?
No.
No.
Okay, don't say no, because you just asked me.
Listen, stop.
You do an introduction. When you go through, you're making a face. You do an introduction before the slides actually come in. Then we'll get to this, and then we'll go struggling through the case.
Okay, that sucks. Why don't you put it?
Stop. Just do it, okay? Because that's what I come to it. I come to it at that point. I don't come to it.
Every drug company has more than 100 lawyers on their trial team. So if you choose to do drug work and you've got 4 lawyers, you know you're working against 100. And for their 100 lawyers, they then have 200 staff members coming behind. So you're always outmanned.
My speech is all the evidence,
since the camera's
and
on,
the
I
questions.
Slap you.
Okay, that's a stupid idea. Don't do it, put it there. Look
then
the
you
end.
Don't know what you're talking about.
Hi.
Okay, this is after. Give me an overview. I tell them this is opening statements. You're going to take the evidence. Here's the issues you're going to decide. All right?
Okay, but you know what's going to happen? You're going to stand up there, and you're going to press page down like you do always. And then usually this first one shows up, and then you can, like, do your intro based on the first slide. Otherwise, you... Good night. I'll stay in the morning.
You know, you're going to find that it's very difficult to get any justice against them. You know, they have endless amounts of money and resources and law firms at their disposal.
Well, I treated all my sackcloth for ashes and took the sorrow wherever and I carry that guilt with me always.
Well, even if I've been wearing new clothes, well, I left too late from New York State for things I've done there I should be ashamed. And when I get back home, I know it'll be your birthday. How could I look at you and ever feel the same?
Culmination of it was when the judge read the jury instructions. I was shocked at the way he read them.
I will point out to you, for instance, the first question that you would consider is, do you find that Rezulin was a cause of Monica George's death? If your answer is no here, then your deliberations are concluded. That would be the end of the case.
It was really disappointing. You know, he was basically instructing the jury to rule against us.
Throughout the trial, at every stage, there was just bad feeling in the courtroom for us. So by the time we get to the jury and we've handed the case to the jury, we still believe in the case. They've offered us money, but I just don't have a good feeling. I feel like the courtroom isn't with us. And I was hoping we would make it through that first night.
We, the jury of Montgomery County, find that Rezulin was not a contributing cause in the death of Monica George. Therefore, in the matter of Shaw versus Warner Lambert, we find for the defense Warner Lambert.
I was hoping we would make it through that first night. And we didn't make it through the first night.
The verdict was that we did not find that Rezulin was a cause of Mrs. George's death.
And we get a knock on the door, and everybody assumes it's a question. They have a question. Because it's not possible for a jury to go through the 1,000 pages of exhibits that we put into evidence in 45 minutes. You can't pick a foreman in 45 minutes.
Bailiff said that there's a verdict, and immediately Zoe looked at us and said, it's against us. It's a verdict against us.
All I could do was just stand there and cry. Leo was nudging at me saying, don't cry, don't cry.
I couldn't react. I just stood there like a stone pillar.
This is one of the few cases the company admitted originally was caused by this drug. And then when they got into a lawsuit situation, they hired the best lawyers they could to back away from what their own company documents said and to sell a lie to the jury. And that's what the jury bought.
We went around the table and each person had his or her say, and each person said the answer was no.
An overwhelming sadness.
Is at times of tragedy and defeat that you assess the strength of people. It's easy to win, it's very hard to lose. You cannot be defeated by this. That is part of trying lawsuits. If you can't take a loss, don't try lawsuits. We didn't do the issue right, or we didn't do it right, or we should have done this or that. Okay, they got hung up on the whole case. So these are people that no matter what happened, they weren't bringing back a verdict for us. It, you know, God himself could have spoken, and they weren't bringing back a verdict for us. They missed the whole train.
I mean, I guess you're right, Zoe. I mean, we did get emotionally attached to this case.
And you'll get emotionally attached. That's the problem of a plaintiff's lawyer. Defendants don't get attached to Pfizer. To them, it is truly just a game.
Listen, nobody got hurt today. Nobody got hurt today.
The sisters got what they wanted.
The sisters got what they wanted. They got a fair shot. They got exactly what it was they wanted and what they deserved. They got a shot. That's all you get in this life is a shot. There's no sadness here.
If April's crying, you know it's a bad day.
They can afford to try cases from now to the end of time. And if they spread out enough plaintiffs over time, they can contain the problem, even with bad verdicts. And they'll get lucky every once in a while, like they did in Maryland. They just got lucky.
And we relied on a smart jury to go back there and read the documents. So even if they missed it, because it came in the middle of 6 hours of hearings that they would read the document and get it.
I love the odds, you know? Win, lose, or draw. We fight as hard as we can, and it's fine with us.
We're in 6 weeks in Maryland, and then we lose. You tell your family that I just got to go do this trial. I mean, it has to be done. It's an important case. It's important to the family. It's an important issue. And I have to be gone. And you know, you know you're going to be gone for months. And you know, you miss so many things. And then you lose. The family loses. And you know, you lose in 45 minutes. Hard to think that it was worth it.
We have a hard, hard, hard fight ahead of us in Oklahoma. But, you know, the next widow deserves the best possible trial team moving to Tulsa for her. She lost, you know, the most important thing in her life, and she doesn't need a team that comes in defeated. They don't care. They get paid by the hour, they win or lose. But we've got families behind us. That you know, that truly count on us to go the extra mile every day.
Monica George deserved better from this judge, this jury, and the justice system.
Should've known better, but it all comes down to this. And sometimes it's hit and sometimes it's missed. And I can speak so free when you're a million miles away. And fear sometimes are the words I'll never say. And when it happens, we're so low. And we're lost on a long dark road, and we all get lost along the way. But we're so close and so far, shouting out a farewell to arms, and we all get lost along the way. Carry me home when it all comes down to this. Sometimes the days gone by, I'll try to never miss. And I can bleed so free when you're a million miles away. And fear sometimes the words you'll never say. And when it happens, we're so low. And we're lost on a long dark road, and we all get lost along the way. And we're so close and so far, shouting out our farewell to arms, and we all get lost along the way. Our Hemingway. Our Hemingway. Thank you. known better, but it all comes down to this. Sometimes it's hit and sometimes it's missed. And I can speak so free when you're a million miles away. And fear sometimes are the words I'll never say. When it happens, we're so low, and we're lost down a long dark road, and we all get lost along the way. And we're so close, so far, shouting out our farewell to arms, and we all get lost along the way.